Dhiral, probably you can text us if you are able to hear Mr. Rajesh's voice. That will be really helpful.
Yeah, we can hear.
Great.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you very much. Thank you, all of you. So before going to start this, I would like to give some guidelines. How can we make this webinar so good and fantastic to everybody? Please keep yourself in mute and don't enable any of your videos. And I start the presentation and I explain you about all this business automation workflow. While I'm explaining all these things, if you have any queries, please post that in the chat box. I'm going to answer these queries on this spot if it is situational. Otherwise, if it is something else, I'm going to all these queries at the end of the session. But I assure you, each and every query will be answered. Yeah, let me take it forward. As Mr. Kalyan explained about myself, I'm having 20 years of experience in industry. Of course, I am with different backgrounds. I started as a Java developer and then I moved into middleware technologies. And then I started working with multiple WebSphere products like WebSphere application server, WebSphere MQ server, WebSphere IIB, WebSphere portal server, WebSphere commerce server, and all the stuff. Not only that, I also worked with WebLogic products and also I worked with JBoss products. I can say that I worked with almost all middleware products. I'm fortunate. I worked with multiple clients. And most diversifying factories, I was working as a freelancer for the last 5 years so that I got a chance to work with different countries, different clients in both Asia and African continent. I have extensively traveled to multiple countries in these two continents, either to deliver my corporate trainings or to execute my implementations. Okay. I don't want to waste much time on this. I hope all of you can see my screen. If you can able to do that, you please text me and confirm me. Any one of you please text me saying that whether my screen is visible or not. Yes, thank you. So today we are going to talk about IBM Business Automation workflow. Of course, you might be from different backgrounds. You might be from application development. Yeah, you might be from different backgrounds, maybe developers, maybe administrators, or maybe managers who are more experienced than me or whatever it may be. But today I'm going to talk about this business automation workflow. You know, we have limited time. We have just 1 hour of time. In this 1 hour, I'm going to give you a complete overview of this product and what it is, and where we are going to use it and how it is helpful to the industry and how we can take it forward in our personal professional career. So let me explain you brief about it and after that I'll explain you more. Basically, in today's webinar, we have specific objectives of this webinar. First, I will try to make you understand the key capabilities of BA, that is Business Automation Workflow. And also I'm going to explain you how this is going to accomplish process modeling goals. I'm going to talk about what is process and what is process modeling later. And also I'm going to let you know how can we create process applications by using one of the component of this automation workflow called Workflow Center. And I'm going to explain you how can we design these process models by using another tool called Process Designer. And I'm going to explain you the purpose of Process Portal, Process Designer, and Workflow Center repository. So these are all the components in this tool called Business Automation Workflow. And I'm also going to explain you the high-level architecture of this Business Automation Workflow so that you will get the complete understanding of this tool. Later, I'm going to explain the benefits, what we get in our industry as a corporate to use this Business Automation Workflow, and also How can we use this on cloud? You know, nowadays this is the trend. Almost everything, all the technologies and tools are available both as on-premises as well as on cloud. I'm going to talk about the special advantage we get with the cloud and all. First, let me explain you the business automation workflow key capabilities. I mean, as a product, what it is capable for and what we can do that. So basically, in this business automation workflow, we get three capabilities. First one is case management, second one is business process management, and third one is content services. Of course, you might have an idea on this, but I will explain you what are all these three things first. First, let us talk about case management. What is this case management? This is useful to track the data and work associated with a business entity. The business entity may be a person or maybe an investigation or maybe a product. To make you better understand, I will tell you a scenario. What is this case management? In which scenarios we can use this? Let us understand there is a bank and which is issued a credit card, and you know they might receive many fraud complaints on this and their credit card usage. Then the bank has to investigate that fraud and it has to conclude it, because sometimes the banks will refund the transaction to us, sometimes they will not be able to refund it, and they will hold that merchant or whoever it is stolen the money and all. So to decide it, what exactly happened and all, they have to open a case on that. So you might have many such kind of cases if you are a bank. So to manage all these cases effectively, this case management is helpful to you. So the people, the investigative department in the bank will open a case and they will record all the relevant data, whatever it is involved in that. And further, they will take it forward and they will conclude it. For that purpose, instead of doing it manually, we are going to use a software-based case management framework, which helps to manage these cases very effectively. And another example for this case management is just like, you know, if there is any motor accident, if our vehicle is insured, we may claim for insurance. In that case also, the insurance company has to open a case and they have to close that case, because they will send an inspector and they will inspect the application provided by us and they will say whether they will accept this or whether they will partially accept our claim or whether they reject. So all these things should be concluded by a particular person or team or whatever it may be. All these are called cases. If you want to manage such kind of cases in enterprise very effectively, this case management is helpful. Actually, IBM case management was itself was an independent product earlier. So basically, the case management product was used by industry and it was popular to manage all these cases. It is nothing but just like an application server which is using, and also it is using IBM FileNet in the back end to store the data, the relevant documents, etc. Why it is now it is a part of one of the feature in this business automation workflow. I'll tell you the story of business automation workflow also. First, let us understand this case management. I hope everybody got what is case management. And the second key capability of this business automation workflow is business process management. What is this actually? To orchestrate human and system tasks in a predefined and structured flow is called as business process management. For example, let us take a scenario. A bank wants to issue loans to their customers. For that process, earlier, we are going to submit an application to the bank. Then the bank will take all your documents and they will analyze your case. I mean to say, they will check your credit rating and they will check your ID proofs, income proofs, etc. And then they'll decide whether the loan should be approved or not. It is called as business process. I mean to say, if you want to do something in business, there is a process defined. A process defines where we should start and where we should close. And also it defines who are the people involved in this and what is the information we need to gather and what is the decision we have to take. And if you want to take a decision, and what is the criteria for that? All these things are defined. In each and every business, a process is defined, because different people will deal with the same scenario and the same situation, maybe a loan application or whatever it may be. In that case, irrespective of the people who are dealing with this, the process should be the same. That is the reason in a business, each and everything is well defined. That is called as business process. But now we are using technology for everything. So everything is automated. For that purpose, the same business process is implemented through the technology. So sometimes, say for example, if you were now if you apply for a loan online in a bank by using a bank application, I mean bank app, or by using online or through some portals like Bank Bazaar or whatever it may be, then what are just they will ask you either for your Aadhaar number or PAN number, then they will get your credit score and they will get you all the details automatically. And if required, they will ask you to upload some of your documents, then it will be taken forward. So in this business process, few things can be automated without any human intervention. Those are called as system tasks. I mean, by giving some Aadhaar number or PAN number, the system can able to extract your credit score and your details and all. And also it can automate some process. But still, we cannot automate everything as a system task. Sometimes we need human intervention also. For example, once you apply for a loan, there should be a physical verification of your address and there should be a physical verification of the claims you made. For that purpose, maybe some address verification team or some agent will come to you, and after that they have to submit the details. For that purpose, they will log in into the system and they will say yes or no. And after that, based upon all these things, sometimes the loan might be approved automatically if all the parameters are satisfied. Otherwise, there might be a situation where a particular person, like, you know, credit manager has to take a decision. In that case also, they have to give their individual opinion, whether approving or rejecting the loan, etc. If the credit manager cannot able to take a decision, they may refer to their superiors also. So in a business process, we need the involvement of human and we need the involvement of the system, etc. But all these are predefined and structured. So we develop a business process application, and the business process application will help us to implement these business processes. So the module which helps to handle this is called as business process management. So the main difference between case management and business process management is business process management is mostly, it's a predefined and structured flow, whereas case management may be an unstructured flow because we have to handle the cases. It depends upon the situation. That is the major difference. Of course, there also there will be a process, but it has to deal with the unstructured documents and unstructured situations and unstructured flows, etc. These are two different tasks. So these two capabilities are available in business automation workflow. And the third capability is content service. So what is content service? We can store, we can manage, we can govern, and we can secure both structured and unstructured content. Say, for example, what is the difference between structured and unstructured content? If you are storing the content in a table in a particular format, we can call it as a structured content. Otherwise, if you store the content in a document or in the form of a PDF file or in the form of image file or in the form of audio file, video file, etc., all this is unstructured content because it stores the content, but sometimes we may not be able to define the structure. But whatever it may be, we need to store the content in both the cases, like a case management and business process management. We need to use the supported documents so that we need to upload some documents or some evidences like audio and video files, etc. And we have to store them properly. And also we need to manage them whenever we need it, and it should be secured. So these are the three capabilities of business automation workflow. I hope you are clear with this. But before going to the next thing, I'm going to explain you the history of business automation workflow. Actually, the first version of this business automation workflow is from 18. Business automation workflow 19. And that means it was in 2019. So what does it mean? Earlier, there are two products. One is called as BPM, Business Process Management. IBM BPM was a product, and IBM Case Management is a product. Now they merged these two products and they defined it as business automation workflow. And that BPM is also it also has a history actually. Before BPM, there were two products. One is called IBM Lombardi and IBM Process Server. So IBM merged these two products, Lombardi and Process Server, together, and they evolved a product called as Business Process Manager, BPM. Actually, Business Process Process Server version 7.5 and Lombardi version 7 were the two individual products. IBM merged these two products and they released BPM 8.0 and then BPM 8.5 and 8.5.7, and then they merged the case management 5.3 with the BPM 8.5.7 and they released a business automation workflow. Why? Because all these are relevant and most of the cases they have to share the data within the organization. Say for example, both for the case management and for the business process management, we may need the same content. Earlier, content was handled by FileNet, and in the BPM itself, we have the content management capabilities. In the case management itself, we have the content management capabilities, etc. That is the reason to make it more powerful, and they combined all these products, and now they have a new product called as Business Automation Workflow. Here, the clients can use the feature whatever they want. Say, for example, in your organization, your requirement is only case management, only that part you can use. If your requirement is business process management, only that part you can use, etc. But all these capabilities are available. But now, in this presentation, I'm going to talk about both overall, what is case management and what is business process management, etc. Because this is just to give an understanding of business automation workflow. If you look at the diagram at the bottom, you can see the case record. The case records will be stored in the as a content, and also business flow, business workflow, its related content also stored in the repository, and these two things can use content services. So overall, this business automation workflow is useful to the organizations and enterprises to automate their business, and workflow is nothing but an entity which implements, I mean, where it is going to execute the things one after one in sequence, either in a synchronized manner or in a synchronized manner. It's a wonderful product, and if we can able to effectively implement it, will be very effective. Now I'm trying to make you understand more similarities and the differences between case management and business process management. Because by this time, you might understand what is case management and what is business management. Let us compare again. The goal of case management is to optimize case outcomes. As I said, in the case of credit card frauds, in the case of insurance claims and all, we want to optimize the outcomes. The ultimate goal of the enterprise is they have to fulfill their customer request as early as possible, and there should not be any chance to the internal fraud. And the organization should not lose, and it should be genuine and effective. So we should get the maximum out of these cases. So this case management helps you to optimize the outcomes of this case. In a similar fashion, business process management is going to optimize the process efficiency. Already I told you, in business, each and everything is well defined. That is called as business process. But this business process management will optimize it, and it will increase the efficiency as an organization. It improves the efficiency of the people. It improves the efficiency of the infrastructure and the interaction between these two also. And here, what is the focus actually? In the case management, the focus is on why the tasks are completed. I mean to say, if something happens, why it has happened. But in business process management, the focus is on how this is completed, etc. And in case management, the focus is on flexibility, and the organization should have flexibility to handle different kinds of cases, and also they should get the best outcome. In the case of business process management, it is all about efficiency. The emphasis is on efficiency. When we are dealing with the case management, mostly we rely upon knowledge workers to determine when a business goal is reached or not. Because there in the case management, mostly the individual decisions matters. We cannot automate the things always. That is the reason we depend upon workers who are having that knowledge. But in the BPM, mostly we rely upon the system. The system is going to determine when business goal is reached or not. So in the case management, the solution consists of pieces which are chosen to fit the situation. In the process management, it consists of the steps that apply to every situation, because there are predefined steps are there, all these steps are applied. And if you talk about how much control we can have, in the case of case management, case workers have considerable control over which task must be done, whereas in BPM, here the process participants, I mean to say the people who are involved in that, will have the little control, because most of the processes are predefined and the timelines are defined and they have to follow the line, they have to follow the rule, that's it. Then what about the flexibility in designing this both cases and BPMs? Yes, in the case of case management, cases can be modified at runtime because it is mostly unorganized and it is mostly people-oriented solution. But in the BPM, it is having the complexity because a business process is defined once, just we execute it. If you want to modify something, again, you have to go to the developer, you have to make the development changes, and you have to implement it. So these are two different entities. Case management deals with the business cases, and business process management deals with the business processes. And both of them needs content services because they may need the documents supporting their case and business process functionality. That is the reason business automation workflow will have all these three capabilities as a single tool. So now let us see the process spectrum. If you look at this, we will have ordered sequence of activities within the organization. We call it as a process. So if you look at that, a process starts somewhere, and there is an order defined what should happen after what, etc. in sequence. All these are predefined. That is called ordered sequence of activities. And another level, another thing is some are unordered or ad hoc activities may be involved in your business. And the third scenario is some activities with ordered steps. That means most of the activities are unordered, but some are ordered. In the second scenario, most of the things are ordered activities, but some of them are unordered activities. In the fourth scenario, everything is unordered set of activities. Then how can we decide and how can we work with it? Whenever we are talking about ordered sequence of activities, we rely upon BPM module. Here, we are going to model a process. That process is going to define the flow of the activities. But whenever we are talking about unordered set of activities, we are mostly dependent upon the worker who is having the knowledge of those activities. So here, in the case of ordered sequence, we rely upon the process model. In the case of unordered set of activities, we rely upon the knowledge worker to decide what will be the next step. In ordered sequence of activities, we are going to use structured business objects. I mean, most of you might know business objects. Business object is nothing but the combination of individual variables. I mean, as programmers, we know, we understand the concept of variables, but object is a generic variable where we can able to store anything. But when we have an entity, the entity is having multiple objects. Say, for example, when we talk about a stock will have a stock number and its price. But when I'm talking about portfolio will have the combination of multiple stocks. So we can take stock as an individual object, but by combining multiple objects, we can define a portfolio also. So business object reflects a real business entity based upon your requirement. So in the business process management, we are using business objects to store the data, whereas in the unordered set of activities, we are going to use unstructured documents. So both are going to use for the purpose of data. Let us put it in a perspective. Look at this. How the business automation workflow covers the process spectrum, because we discuss in the process spectrum, there are four kinds of processes. One set is completely ordered sequence of activities. And second thing is some of them are ad hoc activities. And the third part is some of them are ordered steps, and the fourth one is completely unordered. If you look at this, the ordered sequence of activities can be handled by process applications, which is a part of business process model module of BOM. But when you have some unordered activities, and most of them are ordered activities, we have to use the combination of process apps as well as CAS solutions. In the third scenario also, we have to use both process apps as well as CAS solutions. But in the case of fourth scenario, if you have the unordered set of activities, we can handle everything with the CAS solution. So this will help you to understand the effectiveness of BOM, because as an organization, we might have completely ordered sequence of activities, we might have completely unordered set of activities, or we might have the combination of both. So BOM is going to cater all kinds of businesses by using these two features. That is the reason IBM has integrated the case management capabilities, business process management capabilities, and content management capabilities into a single tool called as business automation workflow. So I think now you understand what is this business automation workflow and what are its capabilities, etc. Now let us understand what are the components involved in this. I mean to say, rather than the technical thing, till now we discussed about the conceptual purpose of the business automation workflow. Now let us try to understand what are the components available in this tool. As we discussed, the primary capabilities of workflow applications is to coordinate the work between tasks performed by humans and automated tasks to improve daily business operations. Already we discussed. When we are talking about a workflow, we are going to improve the capabilities of this. So if you develop a business process workflow application or workflow application in general, it is going to have four major components. One is process designer, and second one is workflow center repository. And we have workflow server also. These are broadly categorized into authoring environment as well as frameworks or models. What is authoring environment? The environment which helps you to develop these cases as well as business processes is called as authoring environment. So if you are a developer, if you want to create and configure a workflow application, you are going to use the tool or component called as process designer. What is the advantage with this? This process designer helps us or allows us to model structured processes. In the environment, we have the integrated workflow server within the workflow center. That means what? Workflow center is a component. The workflow center, you can treat it as a development environment. That workflow center is having a workflow server, and process designer is its GUI, graphical user interface, by using which you are going to design your or model your business processes. Once you designed, all these business processes are stored and managed by workflow center, so that this workflow center is also having a component called workflow server, so that you can run the processes as you build them. So you can build a process, you can run it and test it. That is what we can do. This is mostly for the development environment. And we have one more component called workflow center repository. What is this? Yes, repository is nothing but a location where all the artifacts are stored. So the components of this workflow application, whatever you developed by using the process designer, all these artifacts are stored in a database. We call it as workflow center repository. Here, what is the advantage here is you can share all these artifacts with other users of your same team. And these artifacts can be shared across applications, and these artifacts can be shared across toolkits also. So broadly, in the authoring environment, you are going to have a workflow center. That workflow center is having a workflow center repository. and it is having workflow server, and it is having a process designer also. So as a developer, you work with the process designer, you design your process flows and all. Ultimately, you are going to name it with an application name, process app name, and you are going to associate multiple activities. The activity may be a system activity, or the activity may be a human activity. All these are stored in the workflow center repository. Once your app is completed by you, after defining all its properties, functionality, connectivity, and all, you can deploy it to the process server and you can test it. When you're talking about framework or model, these two are useful for sequencing and delegating the work. With the business automation workflow, the models can be either structured processes or unstructured cases. We talked about all these things till now. In the business automation workflow, you might create a structured business process, or you might create an unstructured case. These are called as models, or these are called as frameworks. So these models and frameworks are going to define the sequence of the activities, which work should happen when, and to whom it should be delegated, etc. All these are things. Here, you can choose your model. It's your choice on which pattern you want to have it. Otherwise, you can define a particular generic process also. So there is no restriction at all. Here you can decide how the model should be. There is no need to be limited to a case, or there is no need to be limited to a process. You can combine both the capabilities within one single model itself. So it is having a workflow server. So what is this workflow server? This provides a single runtime environment. We talked about it earlier also. This can support a range of business processes and service orchestration and integration capabilities. I mean, this is a server which is having the capability to run your business process applications, etc. So these are the tools available in that. And you have one more tool called as Process Portal. This Process Portal is mostly for the user experience. What is user experience? We discussed about it. For example, if you take the bank loan application itself, the verification executive has to say whether the details are true or false. For that purpose, he may has to have an interface where he can log in and where he can give the details. Because one executive will deal with multiple applications. So all of us are working in industry. You know, generally how we get the tickets in our day-to-day environment, we go and log in into our account, so that we will see what are the tickets assigned to us, and what are the tickets assigned to our team, and what are the generic tickets like that. So like that, here also we have a tool called Process Portal. This is the user interface for participating in the processes. So if you want to interact with an application and to provide consistent user experience and also a standardized workflow, we can use this Process Portal. So the managers, say, for example, if you are applying for the leave, what happens? As individuals, we log in into our CRM portal or our portal and we apply for the leave and all. But whenever the manager log in, he will get a holistic view of his whole team, who are available and who are applying for the leave, etc. Like that, the Process Portal helps the people who are involved in this business processes to participate. And we discussed about developer environment. Here we are using, all these tools are used by the developers. Process Designer, Workflow Center Repository, and Workflow Server. And again, Process Portal is for the end users who are participating in the business processes. Then the fourth category is administrative tasks. Because once we have this environment, we should make sure that this is working fine and it is well optimized. So the administrative tools are useful for optimizing how the application runs and how we are going to deploy the new versions of the same applications, and how are we going to manage the security, and how we are going to troubleshoot in the case of any errors, and in the case of any disaster, how we are going to manage the disaster management, etc. All these things comes under administrative tools. So here we have a tool called as Process Admin Console, which is a part of this automation workflow application. This admin console enables you to manage the workflow servers in your runtime environment. That might be your development environment or test environment or staging or production, whatever it may be. All the servers can be managed and you can create clusters, you can maintain the load balancing, high availability, etc. So these are the things. So what we discussed now till now we have is we have the process designer, workflow center repository, workflow server, process portal, and process admin console. I hope you understand all these purposes, but let me quickly summarize it. The process designer allows the user to model structured processes. So in your authoring environments, the integrated workflow server within the workflow center enables you to run processes as you build them. So that is the reason we use process designer to build these processes. Whereas workflow center repository is useful to share the artifacts with other users who are also involved in development process of applications and toolkits. And the workflow server provides a single runtime environment. It's only one single runtime environment that can support a range of business processes. It supports the service orchestration and also integration capabilities. Whereas the process portal is the user interface for the people who are participating in the processes as business users. And process admin console. The process admin console enables to manage the workflow servers in your runtime environment. So that environment can be a development, test, staging, as well as production. So I hope you are clear with these tools. All these tools, all these components are part of business automation workflow. So to summarize it, till now we discussed what is the purpose of business automation workflow and what are the capabilities of it. It is having three capabilities. One is case management, second one is process management, and third one is content management. For this purpose, we have different tools, workflow center, workflow server, workflow repository, portal server, and portal console and admin console. And now let us try to understand these tools quickly. When you are talking about workflow center, this workflow center is the place which we use for the process development. If you look at this, this is the center of process development, which is having a repository, workflow center repository. So multiple developers can develop their processes and they can push into this workflow center. So here we can develop process applications. So the developers are going to use the process designer, and the analysts who are using this process designer both are interacting with this workflow center. So workflow center is a component which is having a workflow center server, which is having a repository, and which is having performance data warehouse. And the process designer is a tool, which is GUI, by using which both analysts can analyze the processes and they can model it, and even the developers can develop these processes. Here in the business automation workflow, we have workflow center console, which is enhanced. Why? Because if you are the user who are already working with the BPM, business process manager, that is the previous version of this, you can see only process applications and toolkits. But now in this business automation workflow center, you can create process applications, you can create case solutions, and you can create toolkits as well. So this is enhanced. This is the central place in the bar where developers create process applications, case solutions, and toolkits. Now let us try to understand how the workflow center console looks like. Look at this on the top right hand side. You can see an icon. If you click on that icon, this is the console of business automation workflow center console. On the top left hand side, you can see. On the top right hand side, you can see the user who logged in. In our case, author one is the user. And there is a window. If you click on that window, you can access the classic workflow center. Okay. And then here you can see the process applications. What are the applications here? So here you can see a process application called as HR recruitment process. If you click on that three dots, that is called as ellipsis menu. If you click on that, you will get a pop-up menu. Here you have the options like update details, export, archive, etc. And on the bottom, on the left bottom of the same process application, you can see click view details. So you can see all the process apps as individual tabs, like application tabs. So for each and every application, you can go, you can navigate, etc. So when you open the process apps in the workflow center, you can select one to open in Process Designer. Of course, you can also see the details, like when it was created, when it was last updated, and you can export this from here, and you can also archive this process. What is this archiving? After developing a process application, if you want to delete it, first you have to archive it. Then, if you click on a particular icon, here you can see multiple applications. If you click on any icon of this application, that application will be opened in the Process Designer. So what is the difference? Let us please don't confuse about this terminology. What you are seeing is Automation Workflow Center. Automation Workflow Center console is an integrated console where you can see all the applications. If you look at this, here we have the Workflow Center. In the Workflow Center, we have a runtime environment called Workflow Center Server, and we have a repository, and we have the database where we can store the performance warehouse database, etc. Apart from that, there is a separate GUI tool called Process Designer. So now what you see here is Workflow Center console. In this Workflow Center console, you can see the applications you have developed, and you can create new applications from here. You can import into this, you can export, etc. But individually, suppose if you take an application called Hiring Sample, if you want to see the detailed process model, or if you want to make any changes to this, you have to click on that application so that it will open that application in a separate console that is called as Process Designer console. Yes, this is the process console center classic. So look at this. This is the modern look of this console center, but if you click on that top right hand side, it will open that in the classic workflow center. So this is the classic workflow center, and what you do here and what you do here is same, but the look and feel is different. If you look at this, here you can see the process applications, etc. Here also you can see on the top you have the tabs. One tab is where you can see all the process applications. See the applications, what you see here as icons. Here you can see it as a list. You can see the application name, an abbreviation of that application, and when it was created, etc. And against to that, if you click on the link called as Open in Designer, it will open in a new Process Designer. This is the classical look, and this is the modern look. That is the only difference. And again, if you click on the toolkits, it will show what are the toolkits available. And if you click on the Servers tab, it will show what are the servers available. And if you click on the Admin tab, you can perform admin activities. The same thing. And if you see the right-hand side, you can see you can create a new process application from here. You can import a process application. And again, you can download a process designer from this location. Because now this process designer is also a web-based one, where you can access it from the server console like a web page. Earlier, you are going to have an installable piece of software in your machine. Now also you can download it, it is deprecated, but still that alone doesn't work. When you download this process designer, it should be connected with the process center. So all these are the things you can see. Of course, if you have too many process applications, you can search. On the top right hand side, you can see the search option. So this is the workflow center console, majorly from where you can see the process applications. We can create process applications, we can import, we can export, everything we can do. These are the two looks. This is the modern look and this is the classical look. And now let us try to understand how can we create a process application. Already I told you, here you can see very simple. If you go and click on the new option, you will get multiple options. Look at this, you can create a new process. You can create multiple things. You can create a view, you can create a service, and you can create a business object. Everything can be there. So first of all, if you click on the process, It will create a new process application that is also called as process application container, because it's nothing but a container which is going to have the process models and all its supporting implementations. All this is stored in the repository, that is process center repository. So these applications can have some of the artifacts, what you can see here. You can have one or more processes. You can have references to the toolkits. You can define the themes, and you can have the services, and you can have the tracks, and you can have service component architecture, etc. Of course, if you are from the BPM background, you can understand all this terminology. If you are new to this, don't worry. This is the terminology will be clarified if you take up the full training of this. I mean to say, obviously, if someone wants to learn this business automation workflow, you have to go for at least 40 hours of training. And if you want to learn both cash management and process management both, at least you have to go for around 55 to 60 hours of training. Then only you will be mastered with all these things. But being it is a webinar, we have the limited time. So I'm not going to explain what is the purpose of it. Just what I'm trying to say here is, I'm trying to make you understand what is the purpose of business automation workflow and what are the components available and how can we create a process application. And when we are talking about this process application, I will try to make you understand a simple terminology. There are three terminologies related to that. One is called as tip, another one is called as snapshot, and the third one is called as track. I'll tell you, to make you understand very simple manner, generally, if you are a developer, what we do, we develop an application. And after that, we name it with a version. Later, we come up with a new version with the required updates and we name it with another name. So what I'm trying to say here is we can maintain multiple versions of the application. In the traditional programming, all this is managed by the version control tools and softwares. But here in the BPM, everything can be managed by this process console center or process designer, whatever you say. In this, the latest working version or the current working version of the process application is called as a tip. And after that, you can take a snapshot. Snapshot is like a version one. See, look at this. If you look at the screen, first they have developed a playback one. When they were developing that, that itself was called as a tip, but then they snapshotted it. When they create a snapshot, they named it as playback one or B1. It was created on some date by someone. Later, they did some modifications to that. That is the current working. So what we are working on currently is called as tip, and what we have saved earlier was called as a snapshot. You can take as many snapshots as you want while you are developing your process applications. So that means what I'm trying to say here is you can have different versions of this process application very easily in this tool, because you can have multiple versions in the form of snapshots. What is the beauty here is you can run any one of this in your server. You can run P1, P2, P3, otherwise you can run the current one also, which we call it as a tip. But what is a track actually? So basically, each process application has a single track that is called as main track. But if you want to allow your development team to develop this parallelly, we can have multiple tracks. So this allows parallel development on a process application. I mean to say on one single application, multiple developers can develop this so that each and every developer will have their own changes. All these are isolated. At later point of time, we integrate them all together. So track is an isolated developmental changes of individual developers in the single process application. Then the current application, what we are working with is called as a tip, and what we snapshotted is called as a snapshot. I mean to say, basically the older versions, whatever we saved, are called as playbacks. Like this, we handle with the process applications. Okay, this is the, I will explain about the process designer and I will conclude, because you know, almost all we are done with all the components. The process designer is mostly to design your process applications. Here there are two aspects, one is designer and second one is inspector. By using the designer, you would develop the processes. By using the inspector, you can run the you can go and start the process center. And once you log in into this, you can create a new process application. So this is the process designer interface. If you look at this on the left hand side, you can see the process name, that is HR recruitment process. As I told you, one process application can have multiple processes. That is the reason at the bottom of it, you can see multiple processes. You can have multiple user interfaces. You can have multiple services because you can call your web services and you can integrate with it. You can have events and you can involve multiple teams. For example, if you look at this screen, you have hiring manager, general manager, recruitment manager like that. You can involve multiple teams. Not only that, you can also see the performance. You can work with toolkits, files, etc. All these things are available here. If you look at on the top, you can see two tabs. One is designer and inspector. Now we are in the designer view. And which is marked as second is nothing but a menu, which is an expandable menu where you can see all the options. The third one is nothing but the designer area. So this is the designer area. Here you can see start, submitting hiring request, and you can see one a decision making, etc. And the fourth part is nothing but the components what we can use in this process design, that is called as palette. So for example, the rectangle box, the diamond box, the circle, all these things you can drag and drop from here. And once you drag and drop a component here, if you click on that component, at the bottom you can see the properties. Here generally we set the properties, we give the name, and if any logic is required, we give the logic. If any security is required, we define it, and if we need to call any external application, we call it, etc. So overall it is a GUI based development environment. But once you have your process, here we place everything. There are multiple teams are there. Generally, this process application design is from top left to the bottom right. That means it will flow from left to right, and it will flow from top to bottom. We use all these tools in the palette, and each and every tool can be connected. You can see the arrow marks connected here, and on each and every component, you can set the properties. This is the process designer interface, which is used by the developers. And as I told you, this process designer can be available as an independent tool which is installed on your desktop. This is what, and second one is web interface. That means you don't require to install anything. Once you have this process center, you can access it by using a URL just like a web page. There is no difference at all. And you have one more tab called inspector tab. This inspector tab is available to debug your services and processes. Okay, so this is what I want you to make you understand. So if you look at the process designer, I'll make you understand quickly what is the main toolbar. And you have the designer tab. This is the interface to model your processes. And you have inspector tab. Here you can run and debug your processes. And the third one, which is marked as the third one, is to take a snapshot. Here we record the state of library items within a process application so that you can track at a specific point in time. And if you do something, if you want to cancel it, just you can simply click on undo. And if you want to redo it, you can do redo. And if you click on that symbol, right symbol, which is marked as 6, just simply if you click on that, it will save your work. And now you are in the process designer. If you want to switch back to your process center look and feel, you can click on that workflow center, which is marked as 7. And you can see the user who logged in here. And if you click on that help, which is marked as I, it will open the workflow help system. So these are the components in the toolbar. And on the top left hand side, you have a toggle library. You can toggle the process library and properties sections both. The toggling in the sense you can, this is for the best utilization of the space. Say for example, if you look at here you have the menu, and again here you have the properties, everything. So the space what we got to design the process is very less, but here it's entirely to the process design. So once you click on that, it will be expanded, and once we click on that again toggle menu, it will be contrasted. So like that you can toggle and you can get the maximum space here. Here you can see the process components, placed and connected with each other. And we have this process designer editor. So by using this, you can build the user interfaces. This is designed for what you see is what you get model of designment. Here you can change the screen size to match for the different form factors what we are implementing. So we can select here, you can see which is marked in red color. Here you can say for large screens, for medium screens, and for small screens. When you are developing itself, you can adjust how you are building your user interface. This is the process designer. Okay. And process portal, already we discussed, this is for the end users. So see, look at this. If you log in as someone, here you can see what are the work. Here you have multiple tickets. The individual can go and they can work on the individual tickets. I mean, it's very simple. I think you can understand very well. Whatever it may be, the tasks you need to involve, all these are listed under your work. See here in this screen, there are four open works are there. Out of four, two are on track as per the timelines. One is at risk and one is overdue. So this is just like our ticketing tool where you can track all your works and you can work with it. This is the process portal, which is mostly for the end users who are involved in this business processes, not the technical people. And this is the portal main page. You can see who is the logged in. And on the left-hand side, you can see the works, processes, and you can see the performance. Suppose if you are the manager, you can see the performance of the processes, and you can also track your team performance. From here, you can launch and different processes. And again, you can see all the works, and you can see the status of the individual works. And again, if you click on a particular work, it will take you to that screen. If you need to do something like submitting something or rejecting something, accepting something, or if you want to give your inputs, all these things we will give. This is mostly to the business users. So here you can see the processes. Look at this. If you click on the processes, it is showing there are two processes, hiring request process, out of which from this process, there are 211 process instances are created. Okay, on which date? Date wise, it will show you, and also it will show the due date, etc. So like this, you can see the process instances. I want to clarify here, what is the difference between a process and process instance? Say, for example, a loan application is a process I defined. So that process that is called as process application. At the same time, 10 people may access it, and the 10 people may submit applications. So for each loan application, it will create a process instance. So each loan application submitted is a process instance. Say, for example, if 200 people submitted their loan applications, you can see 200 process instances created and live. So till you close this, that means either you have to approve the loan or you have to reject the loan. Till then, the instances are available and live. So once the job is over, either accepting or declining, the process instance will be removed. So instantiating, we instantiate process applications for each and every work activity. So all these instances you can see here. So suppose here we opened a request process, hiring request process number 255. Here you can see the data. Here there is no data mentioned. You can see if there is any documents attached, and you can see the tasks. So what is the task listed here? You have to approve the new hire request. So for that purpose, the team which has submitted this application may write something in the data area and may submit some documents, etc. Here it is showing what is the status, what is open and what is completed, etc. And again, you can see when it is created and what is the due, that means by what date and time we have to finish it, and what are the activities. Here you can see which are ready, which are in progress, which are completed, etc. Like this, you can see this is the process portal. This is mostly for the business users, but not the technical people. Here you have some special features, etc., streams and all. Anyway, this is general. Stream is nothing but like the people involved in this process can write their comments, and they can make sure that you can see everything. The stream shows actions that occur for this instance. Here you can post a comment on the stream so that the comments will appear to the immediately on the stream. So you can inform the other team members, etc. Not only that, you can view the Gantt chart for the process also. So this is the process portal. So these are the components. I hope we can stop here because, you know, I can discuss the workflow architecture and all more technically, but it is not the complete training. So the workflow architecture, what is the architecture and what are the tools available and how we can install it and how we can work with it and how we can define different processes, different cases, etc. And how all these components are placed and how these are connected and how we define the properties. All these are going to be a part of the complete learning of the course. But the main objective of this webinar is to make you understand what is business automation workflow and what is the purpose of it, in which area it is useful, etc. So nowadays, you know, most of the things we are trying to automate in business for that purpose. If you want to automate your businesses and if you want to give the best customer satisfaction, obviously the businesses should be automated. For that purpose, people has to use this business automation workflow either for process management or for the case management, etc. So now I hope you got what I explained it to you. If you have any questions, you can post it here on your chat board. I will answer your questions. It might be a technical question or it might be a question related to generic things, etc. So you please post the questions. If anybody is having any questions, you please post it. I will answer your questions. Mr. Kalyan, you there?
Yes, yes.
I don't know whether our participants are having any questions or not. So now you can take it forward. If there is any questions, I can answer. Otherwise, yeah. Here we have a question. Yeah, here I have a question. Let me answer it.
Yep.
Yeah, there is a question. It is in bar. Are we need to have FileNet separately for strong storing content? See, basically in BPM as well as in bar, we have the inbuilt module which can manage the content management. So not required to have the FileNet, but still people can able to integrate. I mean to say, in bar we have the content management features where you can manage all your content, but still if you want a specialized product, you can integrate it. So you can use inbuilt content management capabilities as well as you can integrate with FileNet also, but it is not mandatory to have the FileNet. So I think the feedback link has been shared. You please share your feedback and let us know how you experienced it and how it is useful to you and how do you like this session, so that it will be an encouragement to us to do more such kind of sessions and where we can share some knowledge to the community.
Please do this. Kiran has a question.
Yeah, there is a general question that is bar in the BPM market. Yes, it's a valid question. I'll tell you, when you're talking about IBM products, these products are like elephants. I mean to say, they are more efficient, but they are very big in size. Whereas we can see another spectrum of industry where the people wants to make the things simple, and mostly open source kind of it. So if you are the top layer in industry, obviously BAW is the best choice because people will get everything together, integrated and well performed and proven tool. Whereas if you go to some other tools, I work with other tools also, but when compared with those tools, BAW is obviously efficient and complete. And now the advantage here is they are having the cloud version also, so that the organizations, whether they are big or small, can go and utilize these services. So as long as you need BPM processes like this case management and all, there will be bright feature of BAW. I don't see a competitive product which can give everything like this, etc. So obviously there is bright feature to this BAW. I can recommend if someone wants to upgrade their skills from the opportunities perspective, yes, it is advisable. If you are an enterprise, if you want to implement this in your enterprise, it is advisable, obviously. But the thing is, it is a bit expensive tool. So you have to weigh between the efficiency and the investment. So this is good for big organizations. If you are a big organization, if you are the top 100 organizations in the sector, obviously this is the choice.
Okay, sir. So there are two more queries. So one is from Mr. Vamsidhar. He is writing, can you please share your opinion about IBM BAW in BPM market?
Yeah, that's what I have answered right now. I mean, what he means is there are different products are there. For example, JBPM is there, JBoss, and you know, Oracle BPM is there from WebLogic, and BAW is there from IBM. And here we have a tool called Aries. And there are multiple products are there in the BPM market, but as I told you, this is the complete BPM solution where you get everything together with better performance and with better disaster management capabilities. But of course, which tool will be chosen depends upon their budget, their scalability of the enterprise, etc. But if you compare from the performance perspective and the offering perspective, I can rate BAW as number one, but it is expensive. And compared with other tools, it is expensive. But IBM is trying, IBM has changed its market strategy because now it is offering everything on cloud and they are more flexible. Their licensing policy got changed so that still it is the leader and it can be the leader in BPM market.
Thanks, sir. And Mr. I think Kiran also has.
Yeah. I mean, it is answered in general. I mean to say, see, basically, I'll tell you, if you want to compare a particular tools, if you take two tools and if you want to compare, we have to talk about technological features and the flexibility in development, flexibility in maintenance. And it's a capability, particularly in the case of disaster management, because you know some tools will give you the flexibility, the cheaper functionality and all, but they cannot manage the disaster situations. So that is the reason. If you want to compare each and every tool, it will be a different discussion. And again, the individuals and the corporates will choose the tool based upon different criteria, like budget and the relation with the particular client and availability of the skill set in the market. Like there's so many things are there, but as a technical guy, as an architect, as an implementer, I'm happy to work with BAW than any other BPM tool because it is offering everything together in a consolidated manner. Yes sir, Kalyan sir, you can take it forward.
Thank you so much, Mr. Rajesh, and it was really a wonderful session, and I hope everyone must have liked it. And thanks a lot once again, and thanks everyone for joining today's this webinar, and I hope you all must have liked it. So you have feedback link in the chat, as well as also you all must have received an email also from us, whereby the feedback link is mentioned. So do share your opinion feedback so that it helps us to improve. And if you have any query, do not hesitate to write to us so that we can connect and answer your question or clarify your question. So with this, I once again thank everyone for your decision. And we will be in touch with you all to assist you and provide more such sessions in days to come. Have a pleasant day, everyone, and stay safe and stay at home.